Good morning, Cornerstone Baptist Church. We give all the praise to the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's just good to be back in the house of the Lord. Just good to be here. Rest there, we want to please come in and get seated. We want to be able to be on the pastor's time. Good thing decently and in order. If you have your cell phone on, please put them on vibrate. As Brother John would say. At this time, I'm going to read us some scripture. Psalms 117. Praise the Lord, all you nations. Praise him, all you people. For his merciful kindness is great towards us. And the truth of the Lord endureth forever. Praise ye the Lord. Let us pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, so much more again, oh Lord, that we come to you, Lord, in the most humblest manner we know how. Father God, we come to you, just say thank you, Lord. Because, Lord, you woke us up early this morning. Somebody went into a loved one's room this morning, Lord, and found their body was cold. That means man efforts and attempts to revive or resuscitate them has failed and God has taken control.
All right.
Father God, we ask you to bless us right now in a mighty, mighty special way. Father God, we thank you for our pastor this morning. We thank you for his family. We thank you for all those gathered here. We thank you for all from the oldest down to the smallest child in the building. Father God, we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, and your grace. Sometimes God, serving you is like being a CEO. It's a concentrated effort outlined in the 66 books of the Bible. Father God, we love you and we need you right now. We understand by our president, our congressmen, our local, state, and national governments, Lord, that they do the right and just things, make the right and just decision. Father God, we pray for the those in the nursing home, the rest home, and many institutions, those behind JSA, and those behind the prison wall. Father God, we pray that you touch them in a mighty, mighty special way. Let them know our hope is now gone as long as you have breath in your body. But Father God, we want to pray for our Christian world today. Father God, we want to pray for our cold, stony hearts today. That somehow, some way, God, you reach the core of our hearts. That we make right and just decisions. That we treat people right. That's the only way they're going to know. We're on Christ's side. It's not our love. Father God, bless us in a mighty special way. We haven't done anything right. We all need you. We all need to call on your holy and righteous name. It's not about us, Lord. It's about serving you, Lord. Somebody lost in the world today. Somebody needs you today, Lord. Somebody lost a child, Lord. School is out, Lord. We pray for our children, Lord, as they go about from camp to camp or traveling from here and there, they're out in the community, out on the playground. We pray, God, that nothing happened to them, Lord. We continue to pray for the little boy that shot himself in the high school, Lord. I don't know what was going on in his mind, God, but his family just happens worrying about what went wrong with my son. But Father God, as we got breath in our life, our children are with us. We need to pray for our children. Not only your children, pray for other people's children as well. Children that you don't know. Father God, just bless us now. Bless us, Lord. We need you, Lord. We continue to stand by all our soldiers. Fighting wars here and there. Trying to do what's right. Trying to make our country, nation, safer and better place to be. But Lord, it takes all of us. It takes all of us, Lord. Sometimes we just have to turn out our plate for the evil one that comes across to us. Steal. Show that love. Thank you, Reverend Scott, for the great Sunday school lesson this morning. He taught us a lot. We learn a lot. But we just have to apply it to ourselves. Not nobody else. Apply it to your own heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand for the
All right.
Let us all rise for the responsive reading. Thank you. And as always, let us give God some praise for his word. Oh yes, he is worthy of any praise. Amen. Please, if you don't have a program, please raise your hands and the ushers will assist you. Thank you, ushers. Thank you so much. Our responsive reading today will come out of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 1 through 9. I'll read the light print and you'll read the dark. And thus saith the Lord. The same day Jesus went out
of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore.
And he told them many things that were saying, along the paths of the sea, as he was gathering the sea, some fell along the bed, and the birds came and ate up.
Some fell on rocky places where they did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no roots altogether.
Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it was the crops, 160 or 75 of the soil. Whatever it is, let him hear.
Amen. May God add a blessing to the hearers and doers of his holy word. Remain standing, please, for the praise and worship. Thank you.
Chapter 13. Book of Matthew, chapter 13, beginning with verse 3. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not find much soil. It sprung up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came and the plants were scorched, they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good ground, good soil, where it produced a crop, 160 or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has an ear, let him hear. This morning, as we look at Matthew chapter 13, we want to talk from the subject, why going to church don't help some folk. Why going to church don't help some folk. Because some of us know folk who in church almost every time the door opens. But you can never tell it by the way they live. They can quote scripture. And they can tell you everything that the Lord done said. But for some reason, their walk don't match their talk. And I've discovered if you're in a situation where your walk don't match your talk, you might do well just to shut up. They go through all the motions. They look good on the outside. But at the end of the day, even after they've been in church, it still has not made a difference in how they have lived their lives. And so this morning, as we look at Matthew chapter 13, hopefully we will walk away with an understanding as to why church and going to church don't help some folk. As we've walked through the book of Matthew, we saw from chapters 5 through 7 that Jesus preached the message on the Sermon on the Mount. It was a way for them to hear clearly that the kingdom of heaven was at hand. That all they had to do was to repent from their ways. And God would open up a way for them to have a position in the heavenly kingdom. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. But Jesus not only just talked about the kingdom where they could hear, he was able to demonstrate what kingdom living looks like as he performed miracles in chapters 8 through 12. Because Jesus wanted them to see and realize that no matter where you are and what issue you have, Jesus is able to meet you at that point of problem and issue in your life. And so the miracles were a manifestation that it doesn't matter if you're blind and can't see. If you're sick and you're hopeless. If you've been dealing with an issue a long time, Jesus has the ability to meet you at that point of issue to bring about a change in your life. And the book of Matthew, chapters 8 through 12, were a demonstration. So not only did they hear in the Sermon on the Mount, chapters 5 through 7, they were able to see it demonstrated so they could see for themselves through the miracles in chapters 8 through 12.
All right.
But now Jesus uses another format to teach the people. He uses another format. Not only is he teaching them so they can hear as he did in the Sermon on the Mount, and in his miracles so they could see. But he is going to employ another way and method of teaching called parables. And the text says, as we look in chapter 13, verse 1, the same day, as he ended in chapter 12, he went out of the house and he sat down by the lake. Sat by the lake, and as he sat by the lake, a large crowd of individuals gathered around him. And he got in a boat and sat in it. And when all the people stood on the shore, he is in a position where he was about to teach them more about the kingdom. He's about to teach them more about the message for which he represented. And that is that individuals, no matter who you are, could be a part of God's kingdom program.
All right.
Says, then he began, verse 3, then he told them many things in parables. And a parable is much like a short story. A parable It's more like an illustration. A parable is a way of which Jesus can get a point across and make it plain so everybody could understand.
All right.
He is now sitting in the boat. As the large crowds, and many of them are following him to see what they could get out of him. And he uses it as an opportunity to teach them, not by sermon as he did in chapters 5 through 7, not by miracles as he did in chapters 8 through 13, but now he wants to use parables, short stories, illustrations. He wants to make it plain so everybody could understand, who wanted to understand, what he is talking about. Illustration. And one illustration in this chapter, chapter 13, he uses and is going to talk about seven parables in this chapter. We're just going to look at the first one today. And the parable begins because they were in an agricultural society where there were farmers, where many individuals made their living by farming. And as he gives an illustration, that which they were familiar with in this parable, he says, one day, a farmer went out and he wanted to sow some seeds. And as he wanted to sow his seeds, he was scattering the seed. And first of all, some of the seed fell along the path. It fell along the sidewalk. It fell on hard ground. He says when that seed fell on hard ground that day, the birds of the air came and saw it as an opportunity, and they ate up that seed. Seed wasn't there long before the birds of the air came and ate it up. But not only did some of the seed fall on hard ground, some seed fell, verse 5, among rocky places, where rocks were. And there were rocks there, but the problem was it did not have much soil. Didn't have much soil. And so when he threw the seeds there, Jesus said that it sprung up quickly, but because the soil was shallow, yeah, it didn't have much soil. The seed didn't take root. And the seed had nothing to hold on to. So what happened? Says that when the sun came up, the plant was scorched because they had no root. First one fell on hard ground along the road. Birds ate it. The second one fell on rocky places. And the sun burnt that up. Didn't last long. Well, the third seed, notice, fell on good ground. But the problem was, it fell among thorns, it fell among weeds, it fell among things that were choking up. And as it grew, as that seed grew, the plants and other plants began to choke it up. Choke it out. So that it didn't last. It didn't last long. Got choked out. And then finally, after the seed fell on hard ground, after the seed fell on rocky places and got burnt up, and after the seed fell among thorns and thorns and got choked out, verse 8, finally, some of the seed fell on good ground. good soil. And when that seed, Jesus says, fell on good soil, it was able to be productive. And in fact, it was able to produce a crop 160 and 30 times what was sown. It was able to be productive. Jesus says to his audience, he who has an ear, let him hear. Let him hear. Don't miss
what
I'm trying to tell you.
Come on.
Disciples, hearing this parable, came to Jesus and says, Jesus, why do you speak to the people in parables? Why do you speak to the people in parables? Why are you trying to tell stories in order to get the message across? Jesus says several reasons. Number one, I speak in parable because the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom has been given to you and not them. God is trying to tell you something. And they're so hard-headed, they're so stubborn, that they're so stuck in their ways until they're determined. They don't want to hear what I got to say. So as we've seen in previous weeks, their religious traditions, their way of doing things, they claim themselves to be Pharisees, strict followers of the law. They claim themselves to be teachers of the law. But when it comes to putting it into practice, so I'm talking to you. That's why I'm speaking in parables. Not only that, I want you to know that when you're open to what God is doing in your life, when you're open to God speaking into your life, when you're open to God doing great things in your life, when you're open to God doing something new in your life, he will give you more in abundance.
All right.
He will bless you. Uh-huh. But whoever does not, even what he has been taken from them. And I got these individuals, Jesus saying, that are around me, that have been in church, that have been in the temple, that have been studying the Bible a long time.
Come on.
But it makes no difference in their life. They can quote scripture, but they can't live scripture. I'm trying to get them to understand. And so this is why I speak in parables. This is why I'm trying to break it down. This is why I'm trying to give you a message. Because see, though they see, they got 20/20 vision, though it looks like they got it going on, that the text says, even though they see, they are still blind as a bat. Still, they look like they got it going on, but they still blind. Though they see, they still don't see. And even though they hear, and it might look like they got good hearing, but their hearing ain't still. It's like it is turned off. And missing. They see it, but they still don't get it. They hear it, but they are still missing. Jesus says, well, this doesn't catch me by surprise. In fact, it is to fulfill in Isaiah chapter 6, verses 9 through 10. It is to fulfill the notice, you will be ever hearing, but you will be never. but you will never perceive. You will never get it. Why is it that I'm hearing? And I'm hearing. And they are those who preach that they are blue in the face.
Heaven.
See it for myself.
Yeah.
Beyond a shadow of a doubt that it was nobody but the Lord. Beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has done a great thing. Beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is a good God. Beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is a way maker. Beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is a miracle worker. I can hear it and I can see it, but I still ain't changed my ways. Jesus says, you know why individuals, why they made a difference in their life? Because verse 15, their hearts have become callous.
Come on now.
Their heart is hard as a rock.
Come on.
They're hard. They are just stubborn. Jesus says, because their heart is a heart of stone, because their heart is callous, because their heart is scarred, because their heart is messed up, because their heart is stubborn, and they are determined that they are not going to change, because they are determined, they are content with the way they are. They can hardly hear with their ears and their eyes are closed. Jesus says, but see if they would allow God to give them a heart transplant. If they would allow God to go to work on their heart, work in their heart, then notice what the text says. They might see with their ears, they might see with their eyes, they might hear with their ears and understand with their heart. And if they see and hear and make a change in their life, they could turn and I will heal them. I work things out in their lives. But Jesus says to those, to his disciples, those followers, those faithful followers of his that were finally getting it. Verse 16, but you are not like that. You are not cold in heart. You are not callous in heart. You are not stubborn in your ways. You are not stuck on stupid. And so blessed are, verse 16, are your eyes because they see, and blessed are your ears because they hear. And I tell you, there were many that would desire, many prophets, many righteous, that would have loved to be able to hear me preach and see me work miracles, but you've been given an opportunity for yourself. You have seen me work for yourself. You have seen me come through for yourself. And because your heart is right, you get a chance to see what God has done. So he says, let me break this parable down for you, so you can see why going to church don't help some folks. Listen to what this parable says. The sower goes out to sow the seed, and the seed is the word of God. Seed is the word of God. And the only difference was not the seed. The difference was the ground in which it fell on. The difference was not the seed. The difference was the ground in which it fell on. Let me say that again. The word was the same for everybody. The difference was the soil on which it fell on. Yeah, the word don't change. Oh, yes, yes. Word is always the same. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. 21 says, knowing this, that all that no prophecy of scripture came from anybody's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever the product of the will of men, but men spoke as they were moved by the Spirit. The word remains the word remains the same. Yes, yes, yes. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. The word of God is living and quick, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and the spirit, the joints and the marrow, discerning the thoughts and intent of the heart. The word, yes, always. Yeah, Hebrews chapter 12 says the word has a way of cutting you. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is breathed by out of God's mouth. All scripture is breathed out of God, and it's profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and training in righteousness. The word is always the same. Jesus says in heaven, in Matthew 24, verse 35, heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. The word is always the same. Proverbs chapter 30, verses 5 and 6. Every word of God proves to be true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. Do not add to his word, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. The word is always the same. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. The grass withers, the flower fadeth away, but the word of God stands forever. The word is always the same. Yes, yes. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11. So shall my word be that goes forth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish whatever I purpose. The word,
yes,
remains the same.
Yes.
What ground? What kind of ground is it falling on? Verse 19. Whoever hears my message, hears the word about the kingdom. Verse 19, and does not understand it. Symbolic of that seed that fell on stony ground, it fell on along the path, and the devil has a way. The evil one comes and snatches it up, and it snatches it away. When it is sown in their heart, and the reason why the devil was able to get in there and snatch the word and snatch the seed, because their heart so hard.
All right.
The word could not penetrate that hard. Hard. The word could not penetrate that hard. Hard. They've been doing things so long their own way. What you got to tell me? You put your pants on the same way I put mine on. Sign of a hard heart.
Preach on, Pastor.
Devil came. Since you don't want to hear the word, since you don't want to change, the devil is always looking when the seed is planted that could change and transform your life. And since you have a hard heart, all the devil has to do is just swoop down and snatch it out. Continue along that path.
Yeah.
But then the path, but then some see verse 20. Fell among rocky places.
Yeah, come on.
Fell among rocky places. It grew up. But it grew up a little while. It sprung up quickly. It sprung up fast. And when they got the word, change my life. I'm going to change my ways. Yes, yes, yes. They were so happy, so overjoyed about the change that had taken place. The verse 21 says, since there was no root. It didn't last long.
Come on, Pastor.
I'm so happy the Lord did so much. I got joy.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
In my soul. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. They talked a good game while they were in church. They talked a good game on Sunday. 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 But they was quick to cuss you out on Sunday afternoon. Because it was getting falling in a rocky place. It had sprung up, but it didn't last long. It was short. Lived religion.
All right.
It was feel good.
Yeah.
Religion.
Yeah.
It only lasts a little while. And you know why it didn't last? Seed falls among rocky places. Joy for a little while, but joy that doesn't last long. Third seed, it was doing rather good. Third seed was doing good. Third seed was doing good. The seed fell among the thorns. It fell among thorny ground. It fell among thorns that were always out there. And it refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of life, the deceitfulness of wealth, that they come to church, they are doing good, but it doesn't take long before the devil moves in and start allowing things to cloud your life. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. You walk away saying, I'm doing good. Yes, that I'm committed. I'm committed to this, walking this Christian life. But then the devil has a way, since I can't take the seed out, I'll bring something else along beside you. I've been around long enough to hear folk give testimony. I don't need a man. Jesus is my man. You was getting by. Oh yeah, there were times when you had more month than money, but God was faithful to always bring you through. But now you got a sweet little young vine. And you discovered what you had to do to get it, you now got to do to keep it. Choked up by this world of riches. You don't allow yourself to get choked up and caught up in the devil's trap where it seems like you're in the midst of a rat race. The problem with being in a rat race is the rat always gonna win. Yes, yes. So Jesus says you started out good going to church looking like you. Haven't had it going on. Church ain't gonna can't help you now. Because you don't allow yourself to get caught up in those things that distract you. You allow yourself to get caught up by those things that distract you. Let me help somebody out here. You allow yourself to get caught up by some distractions out there. And you thought that thing was a good thing. The devil ain't gonna say the fruit bad. It's gonna be the best looking fruit on the tree. It's gonna be the best thing going on. But maybe when you start messing with it, when you start eating off of it, just to find out it'll destroy you, it'll take you down, it'll mess you up, because that's the devil's way of trying to destroy you, to get you off track. Jesus says, I want you to know, in the midst of a lot of seed falling on some bad ground. Yeah, that seed fell, that first seed fell among some hard ground. Because it was determined that wasn't going to change. Didn't take long for the devil to swoop down and snatch it up. Yes, 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 that second seed fell among some rocky ground. Yes, you had joy for a little while, but it only lasts a little while. Yeah, before you were right back doing the same old mess that God had brought you out of. Yes, 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 it says, I know some of y'all are like that third seed. Oh yes, oh yes, you were doing good, but you let distractions come your way. You allow things, you allow that job to have more priority. And I'm not saying you gotta work, you ain't gotta work, but you gotta understand, you work a job when they get tired of you, when their money running and getting funny, they have no problem kicking you to the curb. You working all the time, ain't got time for your family or nobody else. Yes, yes, yes. Because you're so caught up in those distractions. Jesus said there was another group. Verse 23, some seed that day fell on some good ground. Yes, yes, yes. It now refers to someone who hears the word and they understand the word. And they understand when I read the word, nobody told me that the road was going to be easy. Yeah, but I just don't believe that he would have brought me this far to leave me alone. Yeah, the seed fell on some good ground, and even though I may have some trouble in this life, I may have some problems in this life because I'm standing on some good ground. Yeah, I can realize and I can understand that in spite of my trouble, I can say I'm so glad that trouble don't last always. Yeah. yes, yes, because that seed fell on some good ground. It says it produced a crop. It was productive. It was productive. It was productive. Yielding fruit, yielding a harvest 160 or 30 times. And we may not all yield the same thing, but if we're walking with God, we all be going to be having some productivity in our lives. Yes, yes. Because that seed fell on some good ground. That seed was determined. That heart was determined. God, here I am. I am available. I am available to you. That heart was determined to say, Lord, here I am. And I want you to order my steps in your word, oh Lord. God was able to bless it 30-fold because that man was faithful. And I lived long enough, Cornerstone. I have lived long enough. I have lived long enough to see individuals that have seen fall on dry ground, to have seen fall on hard ground. I've lived long enough, Cornerstone, to see feet fall among rocky places. I've lived long enough, Cornerstone, to see fall among the thorns. And you know what's so sad about it? They are haters. They are jealous. They are mad. Because I decided that I want to walk with Jesus. They are mad. Because God keeps on blessing me. They are mad. With my name on it, they are jealous, stuck up, talk about me, misuse me, abuse me, scandalize my name. But they don't fail to realize that all you got to do is come to Jesus just as you are, because there is no secret what God can do. The same way God is blessing me, God is able to bless you with his arms wide open. He will welcome you. And it doesn't mean trials are not going to come. It doesn't mean tribulations are not going to come. It doesn't mean storms may not come. It doesn't mean hard times won't come. It doesn't mean that I won't have to come up the rough side of the mountain. It doesn't mean I may have to lay awake at night. But I have discovered that if my seed is on the right ground, if the seed is in the right place, then my God, he is able to bless your life. Is there anybody here? You can show up, testify. I've been through the hard times. I've been up the rough side of the mountain. But I can stand here as a witness that when I put my hand in the master's hand, he worked it out for me. And so baby, you ain't got to be jealous. Baby, you ain't got to have no hateration. Baby, you ain't got to scandalize my name. All you got to do is just turn your life over.
to bring you over. The God that I serve wants to make you productive. The God that I serve wants to give you a blessing with your name on it. But the sad part is, some folk come to church and they leave just like they came. But I've decided that I'm gonna run on to see what the end's gonna be.
Your time.
As the clock stays, come.
those who have come for prayer. Father, we thank you for this message today. We thank you for making it plain. We thank you, Father, for those who have rededicated their lives to do better this day. We say hallelujah to the Lamb today. Because, Father, we know that you care for us. We pray, Father, for everyone that has heard this message today. We're contemplating our hearts to do better, to let you come into their lives, and the seed will grow that's been planted in our hearts that will stay, and they will become a part of being what's great in the kingdom of God. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
what's happening that day. But they didn't have Polaroids when Jesus died on the cross.
All right.
They didn't have Instagram or Snapchat. But they had the wine. And they had the bread. And when Jesus gathered with his apostles on that day that he was going to be crucified, he said, "This bread is for my body that is going to be broken for you. Take it, eat all of it." The juice is symbolic of the blood that was shed on my behalf. The Bible says without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins. So this is a reminder to all of us who have had faith in Jesus Christ that we've been forgiven, that we've been washed. He instructs us to drink all of it. Eternal God and Father, we thank you for your commandment for us to remember what you've done on our behalf. And for the reminder that your blood still works and that it's able to cleanse us from the utmost to the guttermost. So we thank you for your sacrifice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thank God for this day and thank God for you. Let us stand together. Amen. As we come together to
good and alive with us, henceforth, now and forever. Where we all say amen.